This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Today, it is my great pleasure and honor to welcome Keith Thompson to Dreamland. Keith, some years ago, published one of the most important books about the UFO phenomenon, and including our part of it, the experience or an abductee experience, called Angels and Aliens. The San Francisco Chronicle called it magnificent, but you can still get it, I believe, on Amazon.com. And I'm going to ask Keith first where he comes from, in a way, because he is not a UFO author in the classic sense of the word. And yet he wrote a book that is literally a classic of the genre. And if you get a hold of a copy, I don't believe it's even in print now. It's out of print, but there are still copies around. If you get a hold of a copy, you will be reading one of the great and best written UFO books of all time. And the beauty of it is Keith is working on a new book. We'll talk about that too. But mostly we're going to be discussing where the phenomenon is going to go and what those of us who are involved in this are going to be facing and what we'll need to be doing when the general public realizes that we're not crazy and that we have an extraordinary story to tell. Keith, welcome to Dreamland.
Well, thank you, Willie. It's great to be here. I'll share my story with you. Namely, we're both men of a certain age, and I remember when I first discovered your book, Communion. I knew of your novels, which I had not read, and the movies, but I turned on the TV one day in the 1980s, and there you were on a TV show hosted by a woman named Sally Jesse Raphael.
Yeah, that's right, Sally Jesse Raphael.
One of many shows you did. And I was aware of the abductions phenomenon, and I'd been observing this thing for a long time. So I sat right in front of that TV and watched the audience response, and it confirmed the general sense I've had. So how did I come into all this? I've never had a UFO experience. I've had anomalous and experiences, and could discuss those if we want. But I don't come at it from a classic UFO experience. I was 12 years old in the sixth grade when it was my turn to do a current events presentation in class. You know, everybody gets assigned yes. their turn. You find a story in the news and you bring it in. I lived in Northwest Ohio, and that's just south of a state called Michigan. And at that time, there was a UFO sighting in a town called Hillsdale near Ann Arbor. And it was two or three days in length, repeated sightings of strange lights and craft. And it was a national news story. It broke into the national news. Walter Cronkite particularly picked up on it. And you remember Cronkite. This is the CBS Evening News with Walter Cronkite. Today right. in Hillsdale, Michigan, the ongoing UFO saga continues. So I was transfixed. I loved current events. I loved political and societal stuff. I came into this lifetime with a sense that I have a right to be in the public square and you know, participate in a conversation. I've never had any doubt about that. So I studied the case and paid attention to it and got my report ready. And the key, as you probably recall, was when an Air Force investigator named J. Allen Hynek came to town, as he very often did. And he was about at the end of his rope with the Air Force at that time, as you know, because he'd begun to realize he was sort of the front man for a not particularly honest investigation. But he was dedicated to doing what he could. So he came into Ann Arbor and went to all the – to Hillsdale, went to all the sites and talked to people. And he let slip at a news conference a phrase which became legendary, truly mythic in nature. He said that in maybe a couple of the sightings, a couple of the cases down by the lowlands, we might be looking at swamp gas. In the couple of sightings, a couple of cases. Well, the news reporters jumped up, went to their payphones, that's before cell phones, called their news bureaus, and Hynek and Air Force call this swamp gas. Cronkite was outraged, or at least he gave voice to the locals of Ann Arbor and Hillsdale, who were outraged. Their basic response is, we may be from the rural area, but we're not total rubes. And what we saw was not swamp gas, thank you very much. And it was my first introduction, Whitley, to the sense in which ordinary people with credible standing report extraordinary phenomena, and instantly, automatically, reflexively, it gets debunked by so-called authorities, so-called experts in the media, academia, and in science. So I caught that. I was smart, young, perceptive. I go, huh? Because I noticed in case after case after Michigan, this same dynamic kicked in. So I ended up calling it sort of the peculiar quality of doubleness, the two-sidedness to this debate, which manifests at so many levels, and we could discuss that. So long story short, Willie, I just – oh, by the way, I want to emphasize, Hynek did not dismiss it all as swamp gas, but he was thought to have done that. And it played into a general sense that the Air Force was not being straight, not leveling with us, which they weren't, because as you know, and most of your listeners know by now, the Air Force was playing indeed a double game. They had memos distributed, not ever knowing that Freedom of Information Act would allow those to be released. They were writing about it very seriously. There's something here. At the time, they were almost certain it had to be extraterrestrial because that could be the only explanation before Jacques Vallée came on the scene.
Yes.
A different viewpoint. So in any case, I continue to pay attention. And I found your case. I learned about Bud Hopkins. I continued to study it privately. And by the way, in my sixth grade class, when I reported this and I emphasized, why would this automatically be debunked? Or I didn't use that word, but why would that be off the table? I was struck by that. My teacher thought, Keith, that's a good point. Well, I had several classmates who said to me on the playground, oh, you believe in aliens, right? And I wasn't really sophisticated, but I said, no, I don't know that I believe in alien. I don't believe in any. There's something that was cited. Well, what was it if it wasn't swamp gas? I said, I don't know. Well, so you think it was aliens, right? And I also discovered another impulse. You've got to explain it. You've got to have the answers.
What you just said there is the critical mistake. It's a mistake of logic that people make not only in this, but constantly in everything. Like recently on my website, on another show, I commented that I didn't buy into the idea of the QAnon stories about the wealthy people abusing infants. And someone piped up with, therefore, you don't believe there was any abuse of infants by the aliens. And it doesn't follow, doesn't work. There is an expansion of belief that does not follow logic. And and it's what the reporters did. It's all swamp gas, says Hynek. Hynek was horrified by what happened. I know that. Because he accidentally created a buzzword that could be used to dismiss the whole thing, and I don't think fully understood how welcome that would be to the Air Force.
Absolutely, and I think we can let's nail one more, a UFO. Now, what is a UFO? A UFO. Let's just deconstruct it very simply. It's said that there's something unidentified, and it could be identified. I don't know, upwards of 80%, 90% turn out to be identifiable when probed further. But for the moment, it's unidentified, flying, appears to be flying. It's in the sky. That's actually questionable. Is it truly flying? But that's open for discussion. And is it an object? Well, it certainly seems to be. Something sends back radar returns. They also disappear on the spot. So it's kind of a complex phenomenon. We'll get into that. But anyway, UFO. Then the next question is, would you believe in UFOs? I mean, we've all been to parties, and the subject comes up, and you're talking about the phenomenon. So, would you believe in UFOs? And I just finally remembered how many times I would stop. And I've said, yes, I believe there are unidentified flying objects, but most people think UFO means flying saucers from outer space.
And with aliens sitting in them.
With aliens sitting in them. There right. may be flying saucers from outer space with aliens sitting in them. So I'm not debunking. By the way, we should maybe touch on debunkers. Honest skepticism is totally appropriate. We need skepticism, but it's not a separate category. The so-called skeptics and the Skeptic Society, we all know who they are. We find them on Twitter. We find them in the public discourse. They bring up the so-called skeptical side. But I always say that if skepticism is brought in as a separate category, it's actually usually debunking. Because
yeah, it's a different thing. Yes.
Yeah, skepticism should be baked into the at every level. And for most of us, it is. We question what we've seen. We're not credulous. So in any case, do you believe in UFOs? Is it another double question? And I actually came to love the doubleness. I found it kept pulling me further in. And that's just kind of how I'm wired. So
in what sense do you, first of all, define the doubleness very clearly? We've talked about it often. But define it clearly as to exactly what you mean when you say doubleness.
Okay. The first it means simply two. It's as if, and Jacques Vallée has touched on this beautifully, that the phenomenon appears, it appears, it's presented, it's testified to, and immediately suppressed, pushed away.
Yes.
So here's another way to look at that, whether intentionally or not. The UFO presents itself, reveals itself in a manner that actually adds to it concealing itself, meaning it presents itself in forms, abductions of Betty and Barney Hill on a back road of New Hampshire, and so forth. It presents itself in forms and motifs that are, at the surface level, ludicrous, absurd to
yes.
the rational mind. Therefore, the experts come in. It didn't happen. Well, so there's this constant play. It reveals itself in forms that actually cause it to be concealed further. And it is pushed further down into the collective mind, into the collective psyche, where it thrives. You see, we all know Freud was the first to point it out, and it's a mainstay of psychology. That which is repressed doesn't go away.
Right.
It takes forms that are distorted and often pathological, whether it's sexual impulse, whatever is repressed. We all know the stories of the person who, you know, the people who rail against sex or alcohol very often turn out to have the problems with sex and alcohol.
Right. Okay, so, exactly. They sure do. That's very common.
Okay. And so in any case, the phenomenon doesn't go away when it's pushed away. So that's one aspect of the doubleness. I'd say the core doubleness, Whitley, is that it refuses to agree. The UFO refuses to agree, sign on to, and participate in the Western dichotomy between mind and matter. There's
because
supposed
it's not...
to be an interminable gap between those two.
Right.
And most of the time there is. I'm here. You're there. My computer is 2 feet away from me. Subject-object seems to hold right now. But then there are those moments called synchronicities, when that's a reversal of that, and that gap is gone. And when I look at the drinking cup, and it might slide off the table in a phenomenon known as psychokinesis, that shouldn't be allowed to happen in the Western model of the scientific model. In the Western map, it's not supposed to happen. So that's a big part of the doubleness, is that mind and matter are one thing, and our mind doesn't tend to work that way. So we get reminded through these remarkable coincidences of mind and matter, of the core fabric of reality as not broken.
Yes. Now, I made quite a few notes in your book, and I made a note in the frontispiece that I want to read. By remaining at the edge, they, that is to say, the presence we're now talking about and we're all have all kinds of names for, have given us a great chance to find ourselves in a truly new way as participants in a journey of consciousness that is not entirely our own. That is to say, this is, and it comes back to what you were just saying, there is another consciousness here that has a different approach to reality than ours. And what you're saying is actually a reflection of that, because it doesn't, this mind, and it is a mind separate from ours in some profound respects, isn't addressing reality the same way we are, or it would be much less elusive, I think. In other words, they're not playing hide and seek with us so much as they are trying to communicate through the medium of ways of thinking and perceiving the world that we don't share. And if they are indeed aliens, that's very understandable, because their perceptual equipment is probably quite different from ours. I mean, think if bees had intelligence, not only a level of consciousness, but intelligence as well. Their communication with us would be an immense challenge, because their whole structural system, their whole perceptual system, the way they address the world is completely different from us. Someone from another world might be even more so.
Yeah, it is completely different from us, especially in our everyday world.
Yeah, exactly.
And yet, I often point out, I think I might have shared this with you by email, that to me, one of the most remarkable aspects of the famous Zimbabwe's aerial school sighting.
Yes.
And we can talk about the details of that if we need to. Many of your listeners and viewers know about it. Yeah. School children who saw
before it. Before we go on, I have reached a little bit past my break time. So those of you who do not pay for a subscription, and that is your choice, please do listen to these ads, and perhaps we will convince you this time to get on Unknown Country and join our wonderful community. We'll be right back. UnknownCountry.com subscribers have access to a vast treasury of information. Listen to what Dr. Robert Schock said. He's an expert on the past, and for that reason, he also knows a great deal about the future.
We are re-entering, as you say, a debris field. And when you have a debris field like this, it enters the solar system. It energizes the solar system. As you have things going into the sun, even clouds of dust particles, for instance, it will energize the sun. It will destabilize the sun. This is what we saw at the end of the last ice age. In approximate terms, about 13,000 years ago.
And just in the past few days, more enormous meteors have been sighted, and this goes on continuously, more and more every year. We live in a time of great change in a world that doesn't like to look at things as they are. UnknownCountry.com offers extraordinary information, a vast archive that you cannot find anywhere else. Subscribe today. Help keep this website going, because without you, there is and can be no us. Go to UnknownCountry.com right now. Click on the subscribe tab. Get started.
This is not communication. It's communion. Hundreds of thousands of people have claimed contact. That will change you. It changed me.
Lost it. Two words and two dreams.
This was something that I kept buried for years. Strange things would happen. I didn't want anything to do with it anymore.
He came at me, and I fought for my life.
Ships started to pop up in the sky.
And there's this bizarre disk of light. And it is moving across the sky very fast.
The experience is often very terrifying.
If I felt fear, I would crawl under my covers, hoping that it would go away, whatever it was.
I know that we were put in that craft.
I knew I was going to go to another planet.
And the being was right next to my face.
He saw two shadow beings. That's when I felt like I was going to die.
I had a real encounter with something. Even if I had to live with the fear, is to know the truth, is to know.
We're talking to Keith Thompson. It's a sort of interim interview in the sense that he's working on a new book and will be back when it's published. His current book is out of print. It's Angels and Aliens, and it is certainly among the most important books of its kind ever written. He has a website. My glasses aren't. ThompsonAtLarge.com. And you can go and explore Keith's work and thought on that website. I think he's got one of the strongest minds in the UFO world, and I think very thankful that he is in it. We were talking about the aerial school incident a few moments ago, just getting ready to. Why don't we go on with that a little bit, Keith?
Yeah, so I'll just set the frame. I won't try to set the entire situation. The kids were out of playground. On the playground, somewhere in class, but it was a break, and over 100, I think, were out, and they saw a craft. You know, I sometimes say an apparent craft, what appeared to be a craft, but I'm that kind of modifying of language. We assume it appeared to be a craft.
Right.
We don't know at what level it was, at what level of reality it was, but it presented itself to the senses as a craft. You know, they saw it. It landed. There were beings that were around it. The kids ran toward it. They ran inside and told the teachers. It was truly the most remarkable multi-witness case, one of the most remarkable of all time. So when John Mack, the great John Mack, a good friend of mine, and he's sorely missed.
Mine too, and same.
Oh, man. You do a whole show on John. And Ralph Blumenthal has done such good work in his wonderful
Biography. We had Ralph on the show talking about his book about John.
Man. I think Ralph Blumenthal's book, and I only know – I've never met Ralph, so we're not close buddies. It needs to be nominated for a National Book. It's beautifully rendered and written.
Yes.
In a fair society, it would be. Maybe a Pulitzer Prize even. So that's my vote to the Pulitzer Committee. Please pay attention to Keith Thompson.
Really never will it happen, my friend.
So the kids reported this, and John Mack flew down right away, as he often made himself available with his team, because he was studying the abduction phenomenon, as you know. So he got to interview the kids. And, of course, he was a clinical psychologist, a psychiatrist, and very good bedside manner. And he said to the kids, so did it, you say it communicated to you. How did it communicate to you? And the kids in different ways said, well, just right into my mind. It's mind to mind. And he said, well, tell me more about that. He might have said, do you mean telepathically? I don't know if he said that. But because I'm not sure 12-year-old kids knew what that word would mean. But he asked them to elaborate, and they kept saying, well, just the images were directly in our mind. They told us to take care of our planet, that we needed to be better stewards. Maybe didn't use that word either. But so the point is, it was clearly they were describing telepathic communication. And by the way, I'm going to tie this back into how I'm coming to talk about this and why the apparent differences between the phenomenon and us, and how would it communicate to us? Well, it was reported that, yes, the communication was by telepathy. And then that was like a passing detail. Didn't come back to that. The more I studied the case, I thought, What does that say? Now, one theory would be, well, the aliens made the children telepathic. No, that's probably not the best. That's not the Occam's razor. That's not the slimmest hypothesis. It's probably the case that we are naturally telepathic, that we have greater capacities. And somehow in the presence of the UFO, they do get switched on. They do get triggered. So what I have come to believe, Whitley, is that one of the callings that this phenomenon represents is a call to our own paranormal capacities. Because if we if we participate in what are called paranormal exchanges, telepathy, clairvoyance, psychokinesis, a whole range, it means that's always already part of our nature. If it's part of nature, if it exists, if the paranormal exists and we perceive it, then we're already able to perceive it. And that, it's like William James' famous statement to the idea that all crows are black. He said, yeah, all it takes is one white crow to falsify that.
Right, exactly.
Well, so one instance of telepathy, you could say, oh, well, they were prodigy children. No, they were ordinary children, my friends. We're all on we talk about the spectrum. Well, we're all on the spectrum of the paranormal all the time. Some have it highly developed. Some have remote viewing when they take a course or a class. They do remote viewing and they don't even know it. Others are not as easily to access it. But it's as much. We need almost a phrase, Whitley, like paranormal or paranormal intelligence. That's not the quite the right word. Almost in the same sense that we've developed the term emotional intelligence. We acknowledge that there's emotional intelligence now to complement intellectual intelligence. We also need to introduce the idea of acuity to the paranormal as on a range, but it's a general human capacity. And I believe one thing the UFO is doing, maybe here to do, is to tell us that the very fact that we're interacting with it means that we too have paranormal, non-ordinary, metanormal capacities that are most of the time latent, but they do burst forth.
But, you know, I don't think they are paranormal. I don't even believe in the paranormal. I think they're parts of nature that we don't understand. And I'm also not sure that the idea of transmission of thought over some unknown wave or via energy is correct. I think that it is much more a sharing of minds and something that we all do all the time, but we're not disciplined in it. They are disciplined in it, and they can form their thoughts that we are all sharing in such a way that they appear to us to be communications. I live with this. This is the way I live. I mean, I have had now most of my life, I've been spending in a state of this level of communication. And of course, the difficulty is always the same. If you're not careful with it, if you're not highly disciplined, your own material will come in and attach itself to these communication level thoughts. And I have them. I have a particular time of day, 3 o'clock in the morning, when I wake up and engage in this activity. That's how I write my books now. So it's very real, but I think it's part of being human and part of being conscious. I think probably animals all have it without knowing that they shouldn't. But we've made rules that we follow, and one of our rules is no telepathy. So can't be, can't exist. So we've turned that switch off and thinking that it's telepathy, that it's a magical thing maybe done by some technology is the wrong path. The right path is it's simply part of being alive.
Oh, amen. Listen, I would want to go back, and I you've just helped me. You've reminded me that when I write about this, I'm going to be using the term paranormal in quotes, and I didn't fully convey that. Again, it's one of those things, apparently, using the word apparently, and seems to be, but I very often make air quotes when I use paranormal, because I agree that it's like the term anomaly. I think anomaly is not a bad descriptive term in a pragmatic sense to say, well, these are anomalous forms of perception. But let's remember what its anomaly is relevant to. It's in relationship to a model of scientific materialism that we've bought into the idea that it's a law. It's not a law. Materialism is not based on laws. It's a belief system that matter is primary.
Exactly. And that perfectly said.
And it's a belief system. And in fact, very often the advocates of it are atheists, which have every right to be, not all of them, but they want to get rid of this idea of faith. We've got to stop making decisions based on faith. It's damaging our society. Well, they mean overtly religious people. But you want to find some deeply religious people, hang out with scientific materialists. So what my point is this, anomalies aren't intrinsic. They are anomalies in Thomas Kuhn's sense, Structure of Scientific Revolutions, a great book on paradigms. In the materialist paradigm, the so-called paranormal can only be an anomaly because it couldn't exist because materialism is taken to be true. But in fact, as you've pointed out, these capacities that are called paranormal are parts of nature that we have pushed away for 500 years. And when we get over this long drunk we've been on of materialism, this binge, which we're still, by the way, under the influence of the binge, we're waking up the next morning with a bad headache. That's pretty much where we are right now, coming out of the spell that has been cast in the name of materialism. So I agree with you. I don't like the term paranormal most of the time. These are capacities. And I also, by the way, when I use telepathy, I also agree with you. I don't like the send-receive model.
Because yeah.
that accepts the materialist assumption that, well, how does it happen that this gets from that? Why, in our materialist laws, we know that couldn't. No. They aren't laws. They're assumptions. And yes, the communication takes place. But that it takes place is a fact. Increasingly, you know, I think I may have told you in one of my messages, emails, I'm at the point where I'm beginning to say to the debunkers, your worldview is the anomaly that has to be explained now.
Yeah, that's
at this point, very materialism true. Is the anomaly. It's the special case. You know, I love the phrase. I find it exacerbating that in materialism, when they ask, "How do we get conscious? What is consciousness?" The number of materialist philosophers who write books about, you know, reality, they say, "Well, consciousness is an epiphenomenon." Now, I forget what the prefix epi means. Do you know, Willie? It means it's a small.
Yeah,
side.
It's a phenomenon that flows out of something else.
Okay,
it's peripheral to something deeper.
Peripheral. So consciousness is at best peripheral to matter. Well, there's two problems with that. Number one, as we define matter, given what we define matter to be in the materialist world, well, you can't get consciousness out of it, except through a miracle. And so right there you have to say that that doesn't work. And secondly, what do we have access to that is the most primary, rudimentary, foundational fact of our being is that we are aware.
Right.
I am. Meaning I am. The knowledge that you have, we all so often a peak experience, a spiritual experience, an aha is based on this being thrown back on yourself. Maybe it's at a sunset, a sunrise, the birth of a child, a graduation of a nephew. And suddenly the fact of being, of presence, of awareness is palpable and it moves to the front. And then anything that's in awareness is interesting, but the awareness is what we know. We know that we are. So to call that recognition, that which is prior to anything we're aware of, is that we are aware. To refer and to dismiss that as an epiphenomenon, a mere side effect, or as you say, a peripheral fact of matter, which it can't be because of the way matter is defined as inert and dead. So again, materialism,
yeah.
At a point, we have to ask materialism to give a better account of itself because it's a belief system.
It is. It's a decision that we've been making and changing slowly over the years as new discoveries are made. In other words, radio in 1850 would have been considered impossible and therefore outside of the realm of scientific inquiry. 100 years before that, or 150 years before that, meteors were considered impossible and therefore worth only to be laughed at until finally so many meteors fell in one town in France, I believe it was, that the scientific community had to accept that there were stones falling from the sky. But I want to shift gears a little bit after the break, because you were at a very famous meeting at Lawrence Rockefeller's ranch, along with Robert Bigelow, Linda Howe, Leo Sprinkle, John Mack, C.B. Scott Jones, and some others. I believe also Stephen Greer was there. I was omitted, of course, as I'm always the sort. Later on, Lawrence, to his credit, realized that he really should have engaged with me more and invited me and John Mack and Anne and some other people to his estate in South Carolina, Medway Plantation, and we spent a wonderful time there discussing this material. But in any case, we'll talk about that meeting and what went right there and what went wrong. But I also want to talk about another thing when we get back, which is, and this is where I want to start, folks, with the Air Force and the doubling that took place, that, as Keith referred to earlier, where the Air Force had one face to the public saying this is all nonsense, and another face hidden, which very much was the opposite and it was being studied very carefully, and an elaborate effort made to debunk, dismiss, and push aside all of this material. It's much more than simply keeping an official secret. It is an attempt to say the secrets they knew they were keeping did not exist in any way whatsoever. We'll be right back. Did we misunderstand the teaching of Jesus? Perhaps a long time ago, perhaps almost as soon as he rose from the dead, we mistook him for something that he may not have been. But we do know one thing. He was one of us. His life and his resurrection reveal the power of the good in all of us. And his teaching shows anybody, whether they have religious beliefs or not, how to find that goodness and to live it. Get Jesus a New Vision. It's available as an audio book. It is available as a paperback and as a Kindle. Get it today.
Three words: advanced aerial threat. Who in the CIA, NSA, DIA tells at least the United States of America that we're not alone in this universe? We have never been alone in this universe.
The U.S. government really has kept that secret, not only from the American people, which is bad enough, but even kept it from itself.
The UFO community has been portrayed as conspiracy theorists and tinfoil hats, and we're crazy. And the government is now admitting that UFOs are real, and disclosure is here. Suddenly, they're our friend? No.
America's defense establishment is finally admitting some of what it knows.
This could have been a chance to say we're going to collaborate with the representatives of the people in what is supposed to be a government of, by, and for the people.
If what they tell you is the truth, there is no need to withhold it from public.
We've entered a quantum age, making a leap not only in technology, but also in consciousness. Companies are now creating non-sentient replacement humans. They look just like you and I. They're intended for customer service and things such as that, but these neons, as they're called, could be more nefarious than that.
We're dealing with a fight. There are forces behind the scenes that doesn't want any of this information to come out. there's still a lot of truth that has yet to be revealed.
I was one of those quote unquote men in black, but I realize it's probably better now to be known as men in white, bringing truth to the topic.
The problem with the truth is the truth might be terrifying.
We're talking to Keith Thompson, interim between books. Keith Thompson, Angels and Aliens is available as a, you can get it as a used book. His website is thompsonatlarge.com. And, you know, you have to ask, why are we talking to Keith now before he even has his new book out? And the reason is that I'm trying on Unknown Country this year to take this whole dialogue to a new level and to bring in people who normally don't see very much of in the area of advanced spiritual work, such as Fran Shaw, Lee McCloskey, Prince Dirola, and others that we will have during the course of the year, and people like Keith, who have an immensely advanced vision of the UFO close encounter phenomenon that is far past all of the stuff that's basically out there in the UFO space right now, because that space has got to get bigger. And we close encounter witnesses have got to be part of the expansion of that space, in the sense that we have to be ready to face the public with a rational, nuanced, and effective communication about what we think and what we believe is happening here. Okay, let's go to the Air Force now. The Air Force was obeying the law when it classified the early material. It was obeying the National Security Act of 1947. And the reason I say that is because what happened at Roswell, and probably what happened before at Trinity Site, were things that were unknown intrusions from above. And that fulfills the Act's requirement that the military not release information about unknown intrusions and so forth until they know they are not threats. And that was very carefully continued even recently when the threat assessment was published, because the use of the word threat in there was because of the fact that if it's not a threat, it can't be kept secret. And so the threat assessment, in my opinion, when it is fulfilled, will say there is some sort of threat. And there may indeed be some sort of threat. What about this doubling, though, of the Air Force's response on the public side, not just concealing it and not saying anything, but proactively lying? And then on the private side, doing their best to assemble experts that could hopefully make sense of it all. And I'm sorry to go on so long, folks, but this is a complex show and these are fairly complex questions.
Well, that's a great setup. And I'm going to share just a personal story. It's not personal to me, but it's a friend of mine. I happened to get to know and befriend the late American poet Robert Bly. And we did some work together as a journalist and so forth. He told me a story one time. He was a Minnesotan farm boy. And I forget the context, but the story stands out in my mind, and it goes to what you're describing, this doubleness. Robert said he was in church with his wife and children, and Robert was with his mother also, mother and father. And this is a Norwegian part of Minnesota, and I don't know what Lutheran, I believe it was. In any case, then church service, and the kids were squirming. Robert's kids were squirming. Robert said, "What's wrong?" The kids said, "I'm bored." Robert's mother leaned over and said, "No, you're not." Now, the relevance here is Robert said he had to work very hard not to strike out at his mother verbally. He was outraged that the kid had simply said, "I'm bored," a direct statement of experience. Robert's mother said, "No, you're not. Shut up." Well, it goes to what you just said. We will pay a big price for a long time for the military's dissembling on this issue.
In the same sense, paying it now.
That in families, we now know, thanks to the advances in trauma work and multi-generational disorders of families, family pathology, the transmission of family pathology, we know that secrets that are kept have deep and powerful impacts. Very often, this will come around to what you brought up. The best family therapist, the systems therapist, won't even see a single client anymore for work. They'll insist, "Mary or Joe, you want to come to see me? Bring your parents, bring your brothers and sisters, bring your grandparents too, bring as many family members, we'll have a big room, because you don't have a personal problem. You're carrying a problem for your family." Now, let me make the analogy. Let me complete the loop. I believe people listening to this show right now, self-described abductees or experiencers or those who've had close contact experiences, are in some sense carrying a double trauma. They're carrying the trauma that is this society's refusal. Well, I shouldn't say the society's refusal. It is based on, just as in a family, a secret that is squashed down will end up being carried into therapy by somebody three generations later. And and that person is a symptom bearer for a system malaise. Likewise, I believe one aspect of why so many have trouble with the contact experiences is because they've been told by the Air Force and by our government what Robert Bly's mother told that kid. "No, you're not bored."
Yeah, no,
well,
you're not.
The kid was bored, but he was told he wasn't supposed to be. You're not allowed to be bored.
You weren't abducted. Something else happened to you. It's all in your head. All of that stuff is very traumatizing.
And the kid in that case probably, I don't know, you know, the grandson of grandma, you know. But the lesson he got was, oh, what I'm experiencing is not okay. So we all learn to filter. This is, you know, we all learn to put things. We spend the first, as somebody once said, we carry a bag behind us. And during the first half of our life, we put things into the bag. This is another analogy that'll work. We put things into the bag. Our sexual feelings, our shame, our guilt, "I'm not good enough," put that in the bag. Carry it behind us. Well, guess what? At some point, the bag we're carrying of all our dispossessed parts of ourselves gets very heavy. So what we do in the second half of life, we start taking things out of the bag. That's what soul work is about, is to recover those lost and broken parts. And that's why I think this work that Dreamland does and that you've done in your books and others, we're now taking what happened on June 25th or was it 24th of last year with the Air Force saying, yes, there are unexplained.
It was the Navy. The Department of the Navy said that. The Air Force has not said a word about this yet. Not a word.
You're correct. It was the Naval Intelligence, that report that was released. But in any case, it was a reversal. Now, it's going to take – that's resonating. That is what's shifting in the culture now. That's why the UFO is up for discussion, and it's all back on the plate. Overdue, people have been living with these – "No, it didn't happen. No, it couldn't happen." You know, that's the standard debunker refrain. It didn't happen. Why? Because it couldn't happen. Why?
Right.
Because we know that materialist laws – no, again, Mr. Tyson, Dr. Tyson and others.
Yes.
It's not a law. It's not a law. I, you know, when I write my book, if I'm ever on a TV show with Neil deGrasse Tyson, and he starts in with this, I'll say, "I'll make you a deal." "What's the deal, Keith?" I said, "Well, I've spent 50 years studying the UFO phenomenon. I don't have a degree for it. There's no PhD in it, but I spent 50 years. I make you a promise. I won't show up at an astrophysics conference with a lot of rough opinions off the seat of my pants unless I have also studied very deeply, because that's your field, isn't it, doctor?"
Yeah.
Dr. Tyson. Okay, that's your field. I respect. There's a community of the adequate, right?
Yeah, there is no reason socially to respect this field or these people. And in fact, in the public space, the last group of people who can safely be bullied are the close encounter witnesses and the abductees.
Oh, I so agree with you. I've been on enough shows and so have you. And here's the standard setup. Now, these producers, segment producers of these shows, these like Sally, Jesse, Raphael, and the panel shows, the old-fashioned
right.
Griffin, Mike, Doug. Okay, well, here's how it's normally set up. There's an experiencer brought on. That'll be you, Whitley, anybody else. Then there's a scientist who's a skeptic.
Right, and he is the authority figure that everyone's going to believe.
And he, by the way, is afforded the position of he's taken an empirical approach. Now, I'm an empiricist myself. We can look at what that means. It means you go with evidence. And experience, by the way, happens to be evidence. And we don't exclude experience. Well, ironically, the expert, the one who's brought on in the name of empirical science, is actually coming, and we've touched on this earlier in the segment, in the show, they're actually coming from a faith-based position. And the experiencer is actually more of a skeptic than the debunker. I mean, you have made very clear in your writing, Whitley, there's nobody – you sought out professional help, advice, experts
right.
across numerous fields. You didn't start – starting out, I want to believe this, was not your default position. You did what in science is called – you attempted to falsify it. That is how science advances to a large extent.
That's right. I worked to falsify it until I couldn't do it anymore.
And so then you're left with what is. Attempting to prove that something is true is very often a fool's mission, because we can always, with confirmation bias, I talk about this with people all the time. They tell me, well, in any case, we all have our pet theories, and you can find evidence for why your theory is true. I want to find somebody who will say, now, have you looked for any evidence? Forget, I talked to a friend once who had a viewpoint on some subject. He said, I have found 10 sources online that confirm my theory. I said, good. They might look for 10 more. There's probably 20. Now, right. Did you find anybody who would disagree? He goes, yeah. I said, did you factor that in? He goes, well, no. Why? It wasn't trustworthy. Oh. Trustworthy yeah. by what? Because it didn't confirm what you already believed.
Exactly. This is the key thing that we have to work around. And it works in both directions. The close encounter witness, the UFO investigator, will – and everyone is guilty of this. We will have a definite tendency to dismiss anything that flies in the face of our beliefs. And we believe that we were abducted, and therefore someone who comes up with a highly credible suggestion that something else might be happening is dismissed. And at the same time, the scientific community does the opposite. Since there's no possibility anyone could get here, therefore, it's impossible, and that it didn't happen no matter what you think. However, they are really under a lot of pressure now because, A, it's been admitted officially that somebody is here and that they're not us. B, right now, NASA is working on a propulsion system that will propel a spacecraft to an appreciable percentage of the speed of light. And three, the Webb telescope, which is probably quite a primitive thing compared to the telescopes of intelligent species that are even 50 years ahead of us, not a million years, but 50 years or 20 years. Is going to be able to see in sufficient detail, not necessarily in visible light detail, but in sufficient detail to detect the presence of all kinds of different energetic activity on the planets of stars. Now, if that's all true, in fact, the amazing thing is that Fermi's paradox still remains true, because we're not now at a point where the silence suggests there's nobody around us. We're at a point of having to face the fact that the silence suggests that there is somebody controlling our access to the rest of the universe in some way. In other words, we are not alone. We are sequestered.
Well, you know, that brings up for me every now and then someone who knows of my work in this, who's had an experience, they'll tell me, should I tell somebody? And I said, yes, you absolutely should tell someone. You need to tell somebody who's close to you, and so forth. Do not hold a press conference, or certainly don't start with a press conference.
No.
But because I think it's really important to this sense of being sequestered is a big one.
It's horrible.
Another big one, Whitley, you touched, it's sort of implied in what you touched on, that reminded me of a point that I often make, that very often a fault, an unintentional fault, I think, in the UFO research field, by which I mean people who are trying to recognize there's some signal here, there's something going on, that there are many that are not, hoax, hallucination, and a misidentification.
Right, of course.
Okay, so we, in attempting to make that more credible, there is an unconscious rounding that can happen in UFO researchers. And bless his heart, I think Bud Hopkins did a lot of this. He would remove details that didn't fit the standard abduction scenario. See, what I'm getting at, Whitley, it's actually stranger than everybody meeting the same grays in the same way.
Is it ever stranger than that? My God, yes.
It's far closer to what John Keel talked about. They're not mutually exclusive, but you know, maybe this would be a good time, maybe or after the next break, when we I'm heading down to Pascagoula, Mississippi, for my book.
Yeah, why don't we talk about that now? Because in the third part of the show, we're going to be talking about the model for anomalous phenomena that's been proposed by Jacques Vallée and Eric Davis. And because we need a new model for this, the alien contact model is inadequate. But let's talk about Pascagoula now. I'm very interested in it. I think it's a terribly important case. And I think it's a lot of the research that's been done on it recently is quite good.
Well, let me tell you, it's one of the best cases. It's a multi-witness abduction case. Took place in October of 1973. Caught my attention at the time when I was still finding my way into all this, but I didn't go into it deeply. Two men fishing, Charlie Hickson and Calvin Parker, two good old boys from Pascagoula. One day after work, Charlie was 49 and Calvin was 18. 19. Calvin's buddy was Charlie's son. But in any case, they both liked to fish. They went out fishing one day at the Pascagoula River. And Calvin says, Charlie, you sure it's legal to come down here? It says no fishing. He says, oh, no, it's all right. Please don't ever go. Fishing down here is good. So they stood there, and all of a sudden they heard something behind them. And Calvin turned around and saw a blue light. And he said to Charlie, he said, well, you're just going to fix us to get arrested. The police will come right here.
Yeah.
Well, it wasn't the police. No. I say that, but I love Calvin, and I'm in touch with him, and I'll tell you more about that in a second. It turned out, they turned around, and there was a craft, okay, a blue light craft with a door that opened up like on Star Trek. And they were both frozen on the spot. They were, and out came, and this is what I was talking about. Out came humanoid creatures that didn't fit the standard picture. They were gray, wrinkly, blob-like, no eyes, no ears, no nose, apparently, and with claw-like hands. It happened that both men, by the way, they were not walking. They seemed to be on pedestals. Very surreal. very high yeah. strangeness.
Ultra high strangeness, not dissimilar to the Flatwoods Monster of 20 years prior to that. But go ahead.
Close, and then they were both suddenly floating through the air, brought inside the craft. Both had in separate, by the way, with one of the classic cases, the outside of the craft seems smaller than the inside. There's that distortion of the exterior and the interior, which is a very common motif.
I've experienced it myself. Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's, by the way, that's a perfect one for debunkers. So you're telling us there were six rooms inside, right? But it was only this big on the outside, pointing to these kinds of apparent contradictions to dismiss the phenomenology. In any case,
you know, let me just interject for 1 second here. Folks, I want you to wrap your minds around the possibility that stepping into a craft may only look like that. It may be that you're not stepping into anything. You're stepping through something into another world. The abductions might not be taking place in a craft hovering over a nearby lot. That might simply be a portal, and the abductions might be taking place hundreds of millions of miles away or even in another universe entirely. Go ahead.
To me, if we could sit with that one and just, you know, have a moment of silent devotion, because it opens up, what if they're not, they appear to be objects because we expect them to be objects. We expect them to be high tech. That's one of the things Jacques Vallée has written about so beautifully, is that the technology, if you take the big picture, what he calls the Magonia picture.
Yes.
It's been happening for centuries, not just since 1947. But the 1947 or 1945 post version of it has been high-tech, seemingly technological, because we are high-tech and seemingly technological. So it finds its way to forms that meet what we want it to meet. But that's a beautiful point, the sense in which these seem to be objects. They may be windows.
Right, exactly.
Gateways. So, in any case, they both have interactions inside. They both are then they're taken back outside. The doorway closes. The event, the apparent saucer, the craft takes off, disappears, and Charlie Calvin Parker has his hands frozen, his arms in front of him. Hickson tries to help lower him. So here's the point. They weren't going to report it, but they decided after some discussion they would. They tried the Air Force. The Air Force lied. Well, no, they didn't lie. They said, they called them up, and the Air Force said, we don't handle this anymore. Well, officially they didn't, because it had been shut down. Project Blue Book had said it wasn't going to be investigated anymore. So they went to the sheriff, even though Calvin didn't want to. And the sheriff, after hearing them both tell their stories in two different cells, said, well, I'll tell you one thing, boys, you're going to be in a heck of a lot of trouble if you're spinning a yarn here. I want you to know that. Then the key thing, and I know you know this, Whitley, they put them in the same cell with the tape recorder running and left the room. They did not know a tape recorder was running. They did that because they expected, or they wanted to find out if they'd say, well, we sure got them fooled, Calvin. Now, I want you to emphasize that. Okay, you got to emphasize. No. They were terrified. They said, oh, my God, I don't know what I'm going to do. I can fix them to pass out here. I believe in God, but I've never seen anything like that. I need pills. I need some pills for my nerves. He said, Calvin, when we get out of here, you'll get your pills for your nerves, and I'll need it too. My Lord, I don't know what happened. He says, Charlie, I can't. My arms were like frozen. What was that? And that woman inside, they were terrified. And it was only when the sheriff listened to the tape that they said, and Alan Hynek came down, again, J. Alan Hynek to the rescue. He investigated with Jim Harder of UC Berkeley, who I knew. And Hynek famously said, if these men are acting, they deserve the Academy Award.
Right.
I've never seen such a statement. So, all right, so Calvin Parker's still alive. He's 70 years old.
Right.
Next year is the 50th anniversary. So for my book, and I'll describe my book in a few minutes, or we'll get into that, or maybe on another episode we'll talk about my next book or the book I'm working on now.
Yeah, we'll definitely talk about your next book for sure.
Well, I called him up, found his number through his – he wrote a book finally. Oh, he's a great witness, because he's a classic in sincere authenticity. He's been telling the same story, and before Charlie Hickson, his buddy, told the same story. They never veered from the details. They paid enormous social prices. But now we find since then, and the reason I'm going down there is twofold. One is there have been new witnesses can't have come forward, and they say with some apology and regret and self-recrimination, I wish I had told this at the time. I knew that right. Men were telling the truth, but I kept because I was embarrassed. So they've come forward. And also, I'm writing this book for a new generation who does not necessarily know these old stories. And so I'm going to go down there to get to know Spencer. And Calvin says, come on down. I still fish. Are you a fisherman, Keith? So I've already met a friend. I'm not a fisherman, but I'll go fishing with Calvin if he wants to take me out on his boat. I'm also planning to visit Travis Walton this year, who's close to the 50th anniversary of his case. And as you know, one of the best multi-witness, 7 witnesses of that event in the woods that yes. they all saw. They have differences of opinion as they do in life, but it's not about what happened that day. They don't even like each other, some of them, but not one of them has veered in the Travis Walton case away from what they saw in the woods before Travis Walton disappeared for 5 days. So the Pascagoula case, check it out online. I'm going to bring it back forward. One thing Calvin Parker said in jail that I'm probably going to title my chapter on Pascagoula. He said, Calvin, people just won't believe it. No, if he said, people just don't believe this. People need to believe. They don't believe it. They will never believe it. Well, to their credit, they both came forward with a story that didn't do them much good in their life. Clearly something happened. The debunker analysis. So what was my point about that? The fact that they had claw hands. See, I think there is more variety in the anatomy, and I think you do too, of these experiences than is very often reported. But unknowingly, UFO researchers often smooth those away because it doesn't fit.
It doesn't fit our expectations. But we need to basically put our expectations in our hip pockets for a while. Because, you know, my wife, when she collected the communion letters, she didn't buy into, I'm only going to save the letters that make sense in the context of the established theory. She purposely kept the letters that had the fullest explanations of what the person was experiencing, not without regard to whether or not that fit the scenario. The established scenario. And so the communion letters are this wonderful journey through some kind of an experience that's way different from the basic abduction scenario for the most part, but not entirely, because there are lots of letters that are about classic abductions too. Well, free dreamlanders, we have reached the end of our time together, and I know this. One of you said, I don't like being called a free dreamlander. Well, don't. Don't put up with it. Join the site. Become a subscriber, and then you're not a free dreamlander anymore. It's been a pleasure. Keith and I will be continuing on for subscribers. We're going to be getting into some of the physics of high strangeness, because this is absolutely essential to understanding what is going on, and not even necessarily completely understanding it, but just being able to cope with it in a way that has some meaning. That's so critical, and we're not doing that very well yet. We will succeed. We're not stupid. The human species is going to do well with this in the end. Anyway, his old book, what's the new book called? Going to be called?
The new book is going to be called, it began as an idea to put the old book back in print with a new preface. I considered that for a while. The more I looked at it, I thought, well, gee, a lot of the book holds up. But it is a couple of decades old. So, and a new preface would mostly have to point that out. So I'm going to be bringing a lot of the same ideas forward and revising them. But the name of the new book is, it occurred to me one day in a moment of what seemed inspiration, and it still feels right. It's called Cosmos Calling. And the subtitle is UFOs and the Human Response. The Cosmos Calling, Whitley, came to me when I realized as a spiritual practitioner myself that in many traditions, many spiritual and wisdom traditions, there are callings, there are calls to prayer, calls to meditation. Very often they take the sounds, you know, their drums, their tambourines, their gongs, their chimes, their bull roars, and so forth, various kinds of sounds. Very often a call comes in the form of a remarkable vision, as with Ezekiel. So I thought, and what is the purpose of a call? It's to call you to prayer. Well, what's that? What's the purpose of being called to prayer? It's to being called to a new kind of awareness.
Yes.
A greater awareness of what is. It's to move beyond the daily grind, the daily rounds, to a more sacred, more fundamental knowing. There's a call to that. And I said, and
also, I hate to add, folks, more fun, a lot more fun than the daily grind. It's much more interesting.
Well,
much more.
And it's, and also embrace it. It involves embracing more of what actually is. So it's not like an altered. I don't like the phrase altered state. They seem like altered states of consciousness compared to what's called the normal state. Well, maybe we could just easily say the normal state is the altered state. It's a selection and a reduction of what is actually a larger frame that is always here. So when I had the idea, I said, the UFO, and this segues into what we're talking about with Jacques Vallée and Eric Davis, because the UFO, whether it is from, whether any one of them is from outer space, or whether any is from other dimensions, in both cases, they are a call from the cosmos. This phenomenon is a calling from the cosmos to a larger sense of reality that always is. And the human response part, UFOs and the human response, there are many kind of responses. And the history of ufology is a history of all the ways we can respond, from outright knee-jerk debunking, like the great Philip J. Klass, and then other contemporary debunkers, all the way over to, well, it's interdimensional. No, it's ultra-terrestrial. No, it's crypto-terrestrial. No, it's blah,
or time travel. I mean, that's another possibility.
Time travel, another one. There's a reasonable hypothesis that they are us from the future studying us in the past.
Yeah, we're going to have an author, hopefully, on Dreamland soon, who's gone very deeply into that. But we have reached the end of the first hour. And when we get back, we're going to go down some very interesting and deep paths. I just want to say this. The ultra-high strangeness of the phenomenon, I had a little brief physical something happen to me last night. Someone grabbed me here on my wrist in the night. I have only the vaguest memory of it. It happened sometime in the night. There's nothing on the video that I could find indicating. I just remember the squeeze and I have the marks. So what happened? Well, it wasn't my pet capuchin because I don't have any pets. And I leave you with that, folks. Something happened to me as recently as last night that had a physical component in it. This is this experience in its essence. What are we facing? Keith Thompson, thompsonatlarge.com. Subscribers will just keep right on keeping on.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.